Secretary, let's talk about the controversial shortening of the quarantine period for fully vaccinated COVID patients and their close contacts. You do have some doctors who are wary with the shortening of the quarantine period. You don't believe, Secretary, that this will spread COVID in any way or worsen the spread?
Well, I don't think so because, you know, the situation today is far different from what it was a year ago. Because now we have a much higher vaccination coverage. In fact, we have already vaccinated close to about 54 million Filipinos with the completed inoculation and about 58 million with the first dose. Except for the Typhoon Odette, we got set back because we wanted the 54 million by the end of December. If you recall that was our target, 54 million Filipinos. And nangyari, nagkaroon tayong Odette, tapos sumipa, nagkaroon ng Omicron. Pero naabot pa rin natin. We're now almost 54 million Filipinos completely jabbed. So that's one. Number two, Omicron's characteristics are far more conclusive now in terms of the data and reports from South Africa, UK, US. It's mild. It's far less severe than Delta. And you're three times less likely to get hospitalized. The infectivity or the infectiousness is very short, 3 days. Okay, I think you yourself, as I am made to understand, you had.
Our whole family tested for COVID, Secretary Duque. And on the fourth day, with the protocols, the medicines, the supplements, the rest, roughly on the fourth day, I'd have to say the symptoms, you were lessening much less or gone almost for me.
And you know, booster shots do offer a bigger value Absolutely. Against Omicron than Delta. Studies in UK show that if you have received your primary series first and second doses, okay, 65% ang protection rate mo, okay? Mm-hmm. But if you boost yourself, no? If you get the booster shot, there's an additional 16 percentage points ang taas doon. Samantalang sa Delta, ang value ng booster is only 3%. Okay? Mm-hmm. Parang mataas siya sa primary series. So, vaccination and booster work.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, another thing is a COVID-positive close contact who is asymptomatic no longer needs to undergo a test. That's according to the DOH, and contact tracing is not a priority intervention anymore during community transmission of the virus. Can you explain this, Secretary?
Okay, the contact tracing is still part of the strategy, okay? We cannot do away with it, okay? So, but it is very important in low transmission areas. Kung mababa pa yung mga kaso. But if you're in a high transmission area, okay, the effort of contact tracers will have to be poured into other activities like home isolation and quarantine monitoring, symptom of patients, symptom monitoring, which is very effective in reducing transmission. And then, of course, enforcement of the minimum public health standards in the communities, complementing the vaccination team. You know, they need to help also because we need to ramp up our vaccination coverage. Uh-huh. So marami silang pwedeng gawin. So we're not saying it has become unnecessary. It is still very necessary, especially in low transmission areas, so we can cut the chain of transmission. Mm-hmm. But in high transmission areas, mabilis
like
eh.
NCR. Like NCR.
Ang bilis lang, very explosive eh. No? So, bago ka makatapos ng contact tracing mo, nakawala na yung virus, nahawaan na. But because of vaccination, high vaccination coverage in NCR, okay, and in particular, the A2 and A3, kasi tandaan mo, Karen, ang source ng worries natin dito yung mga matatanda and people with comorbidities who go into severe critical. Sila yung na-hospital, sila yung pwedeng mamatay. Ano? Pero in NCR, ang ganda, yung ginawa natin strategy work, no? We prioritize A2 and A3. So now, look at the data. Ang baba ng ating severe and critical cases compared to when we had the surge in Delta. Delta, sipa ang kaso, sipa ang severe critical. Here we see severe critical, well, mukhang konsya, no? Mababa compared to Delta. But of course, we need to still monitor them. And that is why even our testing policy has been tweaked, that our testing priority will be for A1, 2, and 3. And okay. A2 and 3, yung matatanda and people with comorbidities, if they're tested early, then you forestall or prevent them from deteriorating into severe and critical infection. Why? Because you're able to give them, once they're tested, nag-positive, mild pa sila, and then mabibigyan mo na sila ng antivirals. Marami okay. ng antivirals ngayon.
Yes, we'll talk about that later.
Yes, severe. Yes, uh-oh. You have tocilizumab, baricitinib. So, ang daming lumalabas na investigational drugs.
Mm-mm. Okay, before we talk about mass testing, the Alliance for Health Workers and some nurses groups are protesting the shorter quarantine period for medical frontliners. What is right now the quarantine period for nurses who turn out to be COVID positive, Secretary? What is your latest?
Well, ang latest natin, kasi for a while we said pwede 5 days, but not absolute. Depends on the Infection Prevention Control Committee of the hospital to weigh the risk-benefit of such a shortening of the quarantine or isolation period. And that is not without good reason. Kasi nga, siyempre, sino mangangalaga sa pasyente? Di ba? Yun naman ang ating reason for being, no? Is to really make sure there's enough healthcare workforce to tend to the sick. Yun lang naman yung ating objective. But now, we put it the same na, 7 days na rin sila. Okay. Just like for the general public.
Uh-oh.
For isolation, if they're mild, asymptomatic. But still, of course, 10 days if they are partially... but we're talking about fully vaccinated kasi karamihan yes, naman definitely. Vaccinated. That's right.
Okay, so quickly... Secretary, sorry. Senator Joel Villanueva is asking the Department of Health to reconsider the shortening of quarantine protocols for fully vaccinated health workers. He says this is a risky move. Do you consider this risky in that sense that health workers may end up spreading the virus if they have shorter quarantine periods, or it may even affect their own health?
Yeah, as I have said, Karen, the situation now is far different from what it was a year ago. Now, kasi we have to trust the vaccines, okay? And we know they work. Sayo nga, pati booster mo, alam mo talaga, it cut short your infectiousness, no? So we have to, it's not as if we have no vaccines, no boosters, we have no... personal protective equipment. Alam mo naman sa ospital, lahat ng mga healthcare workers natin, naka-PPE sila pagka-expose sila or in directly catering to COVID cases. So iba-iba yung situation today. So we have to trust our vaccines. Here in NCR, we have a high vaccination coverage. We have continue our PPEs that protect our healthcare workers. And then we ensure that we will have a sufficient healthcare workforce to tend to the sick. After all, what are hospitals for? What are doctors and nurses for? What are all allied healthcare workers for? If it's not for caring for the sick, saving lives.
Uh-oh. Two questions on health workers, Secretary. Are you mandating hospitals to give mandatory RT-PCR tests every 2 weeks for healthcare workers?
That is the protocol. That is our guidelines. They are prioritized, A1, A2, and A3.
Okay, dapat free. Dapat free.
Yes,
number
yes,
two,
yes.
Are you considering to give health workers a second booster shot after 6 months or a few months after they've received their first booster shot? Do you have studies on this, Secretary?
Well, I'm sure the studies are ongoing, but right now, it's still just a one booster. Whether it's going to warrant a second booster remains to be seen. So our vaccine expert panel is really monitoring developments, no, vis-a-vis the science on vaccination and whether booster, second booster shot, shots will provide even added protection. But now, one lang tayo.
Okay. Another question on medical frontliners. Have you addressed the problem of understaffing? You have many nurses right now with pending visa applications for the US and other countries. Where are we right now with hiring nurses, Secretary?
Well, the hiring of nurses is ongoing. We have a nurse deployment program. If I'm not mistaken, I think we have about 10,000 or about, I'm not very, I'm sorry, I can't recall the exact number. But the program is ongoing. We deploy them to the local government units, healthcare facilities, to help tend to patients, to help in the vaccination, and other health-related activities. No? So there's a budget for that, and that's going to continue for 2022.
Okay.
And insofar as healthcare benefits are concerned, we have now adopted a one COVID allowance policy.
Okay.
So depending on the risk, you will be provided a 3,000, 6,000, or a 9,000 monthly allowance, depending on the risk that you are exposed to.
Uh-oh.
And we had talks yesterday with DBM and DOF, because, you know, we asked, we proposed 51 billion for healthcare worker benefits for GAA 2022.
Okay.
Yeah. So, ang nabigay lang is, I think, about 9 billion. Okay? But the balance of about 43 billion is in the unprogrammed fund. It's not na parang wala. Meron naman sa unprogrammed fund, subject to negotiations with DBM and DOF to identify definitive sources of funds. And these are all contingent on the revenues generated, collected. And so kung maganda ang revenue generation at saka collection efficiency, I'm sure, I'm confident, baka naman mapuponduhan din yan. So at least for January, February, may pera na for their one COVID allowance or healthcare benefits.
Okay, so how do you ensure, Secretary, that the releases won't be delayed, like the SRA or the meal allowances? Of course, this was a problem last year. Have you changed the system so that for January and February, they will get their allowances, whether it's 3,000, 6,000, 9,000 additional?
There have been lessons learned from the first time that we had granted the special risk allowance. Ano? And now I have told my team to make sure that they should improve on the systems and make sure they're efficiently downloading the funds to the beneficiary. Say, sabi ko, itong January, dapat kung lumabas na yung pondo, mas siguro natin na at least as a hospital na yung mga pondo na yan and yung hospital na mag-distribute sa kanilang mga healthcare workers. So there is that directive, Karen, and to continue to review what were the gaps and weaknesses of the previous system of distributing the healthcare benefits.
Okay. Now, there are more than 3,000 hospital workers in NCR who tested positive for COVID. Will this be considered by the IATF and a recommendation coming from you in deciding to increase the alert level in Metro Manila, Secretary? Will that be a factor?
Certainly, it will be a factor, but our functional bed capacity remains to be one of the two metrics that guide us. The first metric is total bed utilization rate, which nationally we are... Wait, are you talking about NCR or national?
3,000 in NCR tested.
So NCR lang tayo. Okay. We're about 59% total bed utilization rate. So what risk classification does that put our NCR? And that's a moderate risk classification, because in order to breach the 71% or 70%, that's already high risk. That is the signal to escalate to alert level 4.
Yeah.
So ICU, we are at 59% ICU bed utilization rate. So hindi pa tayo nakakarating sa high risk classification, which triggers automatically, which will trigger escalation to alert level 4.
Uh-oh. I wanted to ask
pero
you,
because,
you were quoted in an interview saying that most likely NCR will go under alert level 4. Given the numbers we have today, do you still believe, Secretary, that we will go to alert level 4? Or you believe that we don't have to anymore?
Well, I really hope we do not need to escalate. I really hope that that will happen. But we are guided by metrics. So it's not about my personal view on the matter. You know, I'm hopeful, yes, as you are hopeful na we don't go alert level 4. In fact, we want to go alert level 2. Okay, sa totoo lang. Pero, syempre, we have to be realistic. And that's what the metrics are there for. And we follow them to be objective, no? So we will have to, I have instructed the one hospital command to make sure that they closely monitor the total bed utilization rate and the ICU. And then of course, kasi nga ngayon, as a high risk classification na rin ang NCR because of a high 2-week growth rate and high ADAR or average daily attack rate. Okay, kaya nga as a high risk. But it's the healthcare utilization rate na hindi naman nag-high risk. Alam mo, ito yung difference, Karen, eh. During the Delta surge, putok itong mga kaso, putok din yung admissions.
Yes.
Ngayon, putok ang admission natin. Yes. Mild. Marami yung mild. Mga 40 to 45% mild. So I told our hospital directors, at least in so far as the DOH hospitals are concerned, make sure to efficiently navigate and refer patients to the appropriate facility that is appropriate to their symptoms. Kung mild, bata, why do you need to hospitalize them? Pwede quarantine facility or isolation depending on their clinical manifestation or downstream home quarantine, home isolation. So that's the way to decongest our hospitals and so that we preserve capacity for the truly severe and critical. Tandaan mo, we're not just dealing with COVID here, severe critical, non-COVID. You have acute, heart attacks, cerebrovascular diseases. You have cancer. You have many other terminal stage cancer, etc. Yes. So, ang dami rin natin pangailangan talaga sa totoo lang. So, talaga ilabas at ilagay sa facilities.
Just quickly, no, a lot of government hospitals are reporting incidental COVID, meaning patients are brought in for something else and then they end up testing positive for COVID. How is the DOH addressing that issue?
Yes, you know, this is again a unique development with regard to COVID admissions. During the Delta surge, palagang, alam mo, it was COVID. Now it's an incidental COVID admissions, ang taas, no? But we have to manage them side by side with their COVID, making sure that they do not deteriorate into severe and critical, and of course, address the very reason for which they sought admission.
Yes. No?
Bakit sila ma-ICU? If it is a brain attack or heart attack, stroke, hemorrhage, so meron na tayong mga interventions given na yan, dikahod na interventions.
Okay.
In fact, no, very quickly. Statistics.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, ang statistics, 11.3 admitted for COVID ang mga hospitals sa Metro Manila for DOH. Yes, 88.7% incidental COVID. So unique, no? Ibang-iba.
Yeah.
So it only drills down the point that karamihan dito mild, that they weren't really there for COVID reasons. Di ba? They were there for other indications.
Okay. Now, let's talk about mass testing. The question after 2 years is why don't we have free mass testing? We're seeing other countries that they can get their RT-PCR for free. As you know, Secretary, until today, you have RT-PCR at 3,500, 4,000 on the average. And you, in other words, you still have to pay. Does the DOH have the funds to put up pop-up testing centers, swab booths, so we can test for free? Is that still a dream? Is that possible?
Wala na, Karen, you look at America with the highest testing output, yes. Halos mga 900, 1 million a day yata. But look at where they are in terms of cases. So does mass testing work here in this very good example? It doesn't. Look at the first world countries with very high testing output. Mm-hmm. But look at them. Why? Because imbis na mag-mask sila, mag-social distance, akala nila yung testing makakatulong. You know, in the Lancet journal, there is a very nice document here. No? Yung random mass testing, 5% of population per week, 2% lang ang kanyang risk reduction value. So very, very small. I'll give you, let's do the math, Karen, very quickly. Pagpalagay natin, we need to, kung 5% of the population, ilan tayo? 100 million. So 5 million per week. Divided by 7. That's 700,000 tests per day. Lagay mo na on the average, 2,000 pesos per test. So 700,000 times 2,000 pesos per test. How much is that? That is 1.4 billion a day. Okay? That is 14 billion every 10 days. That's 42 billion in 1 month. My God, I'd rather put that money for my healthcare worker benefits, for ayuda in communities that are doing granular lockdowns. That's the way to put these huge sums of money to best use. Magte-test ka. We continue our policy of targeted risk-based testing. Ay, alam na naman natin, sino ba na ospital? Sino ba nagsisevere? A2, A3. Abit natin, gagastos ang napakalaking pondo. But this is not to say na wala tayong funding for testing. Meron. In fact, we had
passed 16 million. Like, yeah, or what about this 7.9 billion fund in 2022? I think that it says here it's your budget for the COVID lab network. Correct. And they want it a move to testing. Is that correct, Secretary?
That kasama yan. Testing. Yan yung testing. Oh. Yung lab, RT-PCR yan for the large part. And that, in fact, is short of our proposed budget of 16 billion. Mm-hmm. So again, the balance we will have to source after our talks with DBM and DOF to identify sources of funding to bridge the gap of about 9 billion pa ang shortfall.
Well,
And then PhilHealth-based, by the way. No? PhilHealth kasi, if you're hospitalized, okay, PhilHealth reimburses. In fact, we have already reimbursed close to about 8 or 9 billion pesos worth of testing claims from PhilHealth.
Yeah. And well, an interesting part I just wanted to say out of experience, I wanted to ask you where you stand on home antigen kits. Because what's interesting in antigen testing, if you test positive on the antigen, you're really most likely positive for COVID. But if you test negative, there's still a possibility you're asymptomatic and you're positive. So I find these home antigen kits quite helpful for families. And what do you think of that, Secretary? I know it's been controversial in the DOH. It's been discouraged for a time. Where do you stand on this now?
Kasi ganito yan, ano? If you are symptomatic, and now especially in the Omicron regime that's evolving, why not just simply isolate yourself, especially if you're symptomatic? Mm-hmm. Or if you have been in close contact with a positive COVID individual,
you go ahead ka na lang.
Mag-isolate ka na lang. Because ano ba ang outcome natin? Di ba outcome natin is to let you recover and at the same time not spread the virus. Okay? Why should I need to wait to do home test and then pagka nag-negative, I have a false sense of security. Ah, negative ako, lalabas na ako. Eh, hindi naman tama yon. Kung negative ka, especially kung symptomatic ka, you have to stay at home. You have to keep yourself and recover and not spread the virus. Now, you have to understand, Karen, that 40% of Omicron cases are asymptomatic.
Yes.
Asymptomatic, wala.
Yeah.
So lalabas ka.
Yeah. So what you're saying, Secretary, ka, it's a change in protocol, in mindset. You have to be already in the mindset of you're living with a virus. You have a symptom, magkusa ka na. isolate and call people that you've actually seen. That's actually what I did.
Yeah. So pandemic to endemic na tayo. You have to learn to live with the virus. One step back, two steps forward. Okay? Mm-hmm. And you still have a net gain. Okay? Now, 40% of Omicron cases are known to be asymptomatic. Okay? So lalabas ka. Bakit ka? Why will you stay at home? You're asymptomatic. You don't feel anything. That's why all the more you have to wear the mask.
Yeah.
Social distance and hand hygiene, greater than 95% protection in reducing transmission. Ang laki-laki, no? And then, of course, the antigen testing does not provide accurate result for the asymptomatic.
Exactly.
So it's still MPHS. Tingnan mo America, tingnan mo UK, tingnan mo ang tataas ng testing. Patas ng kaso, nag-1 million pa yung iba a day, ha? Pero tingnan mo yung masking compliance, poor.
I'm curious, Secretary, that's a good point, but will there come a time when RT-PCR tests either would be free or will be priced lower in the Philippines?
Yeah, we're working to lower the price. We're doing that now.
I was going to say,
We already lowered it now from what it used to be. Yeah. Now it's, I think, for government, mga 2.8 for plate-based and then for cartridge-based, 2.4. But if these tests kits are not given by government, parang 900 pesos na nga lang eh.
Uh-oh. But these private labs are really making money off the testing.
Perhaps. I'm not
is that possible?
Sure.
I mean, I'm curious. Could the government set a cap?
There is a cap. We'll submit to you a joint memorandum circular with DTI on the setting of limits or caps.
Okay. All right. A few more questions. Let's have some good news. Paxlovid. Okay, Paxlovid. Is that the local or generic name of Paxlovid? Pfizer's Paxlovid. And it will be available with the DOH. Is that correct, Secretary?
Well, the negotiations are still ongoing.
Okay.
The Paxlovid is the equivalent of Paxlovid, which is a drug developed by Pfizer.
Yeah.
This drug consists of two components. One is the nirmatrelvir and the ritonavir. And there have been, in the clinical trial data submitted, they haven't submitted it to us, but, you know, information elsewhere shows that this can reduce the risk of progressing into severe and critical COVID by 89% to 90%.
Yes. Actually, very stronger, good. Stronger than molnupiravir.
Malayo, molnupiravir nag-regress from 50% to 30%. Okay, yeah. So para sa akin, we should reserve these antivirals, okay, these new investigational antivirals for the vulnerable group. Yeah. We cannot give it, you know, every Tom, Dick, and Harry. Yeah. You have to give it only. And they're not without much cost. Huh? Mahal ito. Because Paxlovid, it looks like it's 13,555
really?
For one treatment course. Yeah, per box. For one treatment course for 5 days. Two tabs twice a day. So ang mahal-mahal nito. No?
Yeah.
So that's why you reserve them for the truly vulnerable. A2, A3. So that they do not deteriorate or you forestall the progression to severe and critical COVID infection. And so that you also prevent hospitalization.
So you're answering my question now because ang molnupiravir, you can get it, for example, kay Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, kay Vice President Lenny Robredo, basta may prescription. Ang Paxlovid, kung may prescription ang doktor, can we get it from the DOH? Or how do you intend to distribute Paxlovid? Clearly, you won't sell it, right? The DOH won't be selling that.
You cannot sell that because, you know, it has to be given for free under, right now, the Paxlovid has applied for compassionate special permit.
Okay.
And verily, you cannot just give that, prescribe it to anyone. It will have to comply with the conditions for which the CSP was granted. And it's a very stringent condition. Remember, Karen, We are hopeful about these new antivirals, but we should also be wary at the same time of the potential side effects.
Yeah.
And usually the side effects, yes, long-term yan. So the pharmacovigilance has to be really strong to monitor the use of such new and investigational drugs under CSP or EUA.
Okay, my next question is vaccine shots for 5 to 11 years old. When will that start, Secretary? Where are we in terms of purchasing a Pfizer for 5 to 11 years old?
Okay na yan. It's just the delivery na lang inaantay. And I understand from Secretary Charlie, the delivery has been advanced by 1 week. So I don't know if it is going to be last week of January or first week of February, but let me just check on that again with Secretary Galvez.
Okay. Another question here from actually a mother who's watching you. Secretary, can my 12-year-old have booster shots?
12 to 17 kasi pinayagan na natin. So they can have booster shots after 3 months from the last from the second dose of a primary series. So if it is 2 doses, so the last dose, 3 months, then you can have booster.
Mm-mm. Okay. You have Senate reporters watching you right now asking, can you please ask Secretary, Senator Sunny Angara said there are allotted funds for contact tracers, free tests for the general public in government facilities in the 2022 national budget. When will the public enjoy this supposed free test and who can qualify, Secretary?
Well, our policy remains, okay, Karen? It is a risk-based targeted testing. So people who are symptomatic, people who are close contacts of those tested positive. Mm-hmm. And also we can do for surveillance to see more or less what is the prevalence of the infection in a given community. And that remains to be our policy. And I think it is a very smart, it is a wise policy that we will continue. We will test those who are really symptomatics and the vulnerable. Testing A1, A2, and A3. You and I know, with the vaccines now, this has rendered COVID a lot less, you know, they're mild, okay? Short infectiousness, okay? So, ibang panahon ngayon, hindi gaya dati, wala tayo ni isang drop of vaccines to speak of. And yet, during our July, August of 2020 surge, we managed to bring it down. And nag-plateau siya lang mahaba until nag-super spreader events naman tayo ng Christmas, ng New Year's. But we had no vaccine to speak of. We only relied on masks, hugas, iwas, ventilation with greater than 95% protection rate. So this is something that we have to really hold dear as something effective. In our pandemic response, there are 2 things, okay? Vaccinate, vaccinate, vaccinate. Asawa nito, mag-asawa ito, hindi pwedeng vaccination lang.
Wear your mask.
Yes. Mag-asawa to. No virus should put them asunder.
Okay. All right. Another question here from our Senate reporter. How does the DOH intend to address, although I asked this already, the appeal of the public to provide cheaper tests for the rest of the nation? Yes, I think that's a general call. I can say people call private labs a secretary, you know? So ang tanong really is something like, is it possible for private labs talaga to have a cap of 2,000? For RT-PCR testing.
I think that's possible.
Pwede ba yun?
Pwede yun. We will review again because, you know, we need to scope the market. We will see as more and more players, testing kit manufacturers are in the market. We will, I'm sure this is going to push the prices down. So, dati nga, 4,000 tayo. Eh, ngayon, 2,800 for plate-based. Gene Expert, 2,450. Tapos, a private, 3,300. Tapos 2,900 for Gene Expert sa private. Ngayon, syempre, doon naman sa public, dahil libre naman yung test kit, pwedeng maging 900 nga lang yan per test. So we're continuously monitoring this. We will come up again with another round of price reduction.
Okay. Two last questions, Secretary. More on a practical note is... with so many people getting COVID this January because of Omicron, and you've already said it's the dominant variant. Many have asked that there's a lack of information on how to treat themselves at home. That's one. That's why sa Mercury Drug, all the drug stores, people are like hoarding things sometimes that they don't need, or they're getting things, too much of medicines they actually don't need that somebody else can use. That's one. And number two, why is it 2 years into the pandemic, wala pang COVID home kit na ipinamibigay daw ang DOH? Other countries, if you test COVID, kapag mahirap ka, may home kit na. O eto, nandito na po ang antibiotics, andito na ang vitamin C. Sa ibang bansa kasi may ivermectin, pero nasa isang pakete na. Ang tanong, Secretary, ba't sa atin walang ganung kit na pwede ibigay na lang itong kailangan mo?
Ah, yes, lalo na sa, para sa mga mahihirap.
Meron na tayo. Nalibre, no? Nalibre.
Yes, yes. Going, ang tawag namin Kalinga Kit. It will soon be launched pretty soon. We've already about close to about 35,000 put together. So we'll start distributing them. But we're also asking other well-meaning companies to help us, yes, to co-brand DOH with them and then provide a home kit with 5 pieces of mask, with alcohol, with thermometer, with paracetamol, hopefully, yeah. I think Lagundi for Antica.
Yes, and I actually use that. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And yeah. So we will couple this with the PhilHealth board has already decided to roll out the COVID home isolation benefit package, yeah, at 6,000 pesos. So meron na rin yan. So now it's just really pushing it and doing a social marketing campaign for better public uptake and for buy-in by the local chief executives so that they can champion this benefit package for use while in home isolation or quarantine.
Okay. My last question, sorry, I know you have a meeting, is what areas are you seeing, Secretary, where there's still vaccine hesitancy? Because clearly, we don't have a problem with vaccine supply anymore. Joey Concepcion said, I think you have like 100 million, tama, no? Doses in the country today.
Yes, yes, that is correct. The supply is no longer a problem.
Yeah.
But, the vaccine hesitancy is also decreasing. The latest SWS, if I recall correctly, I think about 66 or 68% of Filipinos are now willing to get jabbed. So we need to work on the balance, okay, of about 32%. That is where the vaccine hesitancy is. And in the same survey, it looks like the lower the educational attainment, the higher the vaccine resistance. Yeah. So we need to really make sure that proper education, incentivization of vaccination will have to be ramped up. And that is what our local government units are doing. I told them to champion vaccination. It's very important. It's a health issue. It's something that they can well represent before their constituents. And so that's what I am pushing for them to do.
Mm-mm. Okay. Secretary Francisco Duque, thank you for joining me today. This was quite informative. Is there anything you'd like to add before we go?
Yeah, gusto ko lang iparating sa ating mga kababayan, Karen, ano, na ang tugon sa pandemyang ito, sa ngayon nakikita natin na mamayagpag ang Omicron sa buong mundo, ano, at tayo kasama na dyan. Mabilis ang hawaan, 40% asymptomatic sa Omicron cases, kaya kinakailangan mas magsuot po tayo, gawin ang mas hugas iwas, at pag-iwas naman doon sa crowded three C's, crowded places, crowded closed spaces, crowded areas, and close contact settings. So wag na kayo mag-iimbita ng mga tao sa bahay ninyo na hindi nyo naman alam kung sila na-expose. Kaya nga tayo tumalon dahil nung nagpasko at saka nag-New Year, nag-imbitahan ng mga tao. Siyempre, kumakain. Pagka kumain ka, tanggalin mo yung mask mo. So you spew. Tandaan mo, the Omicron variant, the virus, is rich in the throat, in the upper respiratory tract. And so it's very efficient in spewing it out and spreading the virus. So we should really avoid all these situations or conditions. No? So get vaccinated, okay? Get boosted if it's your turn. Ang mga lolo, lola po, ako po'y nagmamakaawa, magpabakuna po tayo. Kayo po kasi ang talagang namamahay sa mga ospital at ICU. At maawa na rin po tayo sa ating po mga healthcare workers na dalawang taon na po nilang binubuno itong problemang ito. Yeah. Kanya parang awa na niya, magpabakuna na po tayo. May taglay na protection po ito laban sa anumang variant, alpha, beta, delta, gamma, omicron. Yan pa rin po ang ating napatunayan epektibo laban po sa pandemyang ito. At of course, yung isolate. Pagka nagkaroon ng pakiramdam, huwag na magantay ng antigen test, kung ano-ano, mag-isolate na lang po kayo. At buong pamilya, mag-quarantine na kayo. Kung talagang tingin nyo naman, eh na-expose kayo, lalo na yung may kilalang na-expose sa mga positive na mga individuals, eh mag-quarantine at mag-isolate. Yan po, matatagumpayan natin ang laban na ito. Bababa din po itong kasong ito. Maniwala po kayo. Gaya na napababa din natin yung mga dating surges. Maraming salamat po.
Wait, last question. Sorry.
Ikaw talaga.
No, the silver lining with Omicron and so many cases now, could this give us the herd immunity that we've wanted, Secretary, or still no?
No, yung herd immunity we're veering away from the concept of the herd immunity because we know there is breakthrough infection even if you're vaccinated, okay? So you still get infected and you can still infect others, okay? So it's really population protection and really monitoring, making sure that the vulnerable groups are really protected. Yun ang number one. And then later on, hopefully this will become, knock on the wood, like a common cold.
Yeah.
That, I think, is the silver lining.
All right. On that note, Health Secretary Francisco Duque, thank you for joining me today, sir. A happy new year to you. You take care.
Same to you, Karen. Thank you on behalf of the DOH and IATF. Salamat po.